Hello, my name is Forrest, and I'm a product marketing engineer with the Comparators Group. I'd like to share with you a few of the more unique applications for comparators and how the specific specifications of high-speed comparators can make a difference. Before we get started, here is a quick table of contents of the topics we are going to cover. Now, most of you are already familiar with comparators, and you probably know them as small, simple ICs, like amplifiers, that cover basic system needs, such as voltage monitoring, current detection, or even temperature changes. We call these common housekeeping applications, nothing too complicated or fancy. But over the last 3 years, we've been working to change this perception with our new ultra-high-speed comparators. We, in the comparators product line, have pushed the bounds of technology, releasing TI's fastest comparator ever, as well as the fastest comparators on the market for both push-pull and LVDS outputs. In doing so, we have enabled comparators to perform in non-traditional roles and opened up new markets for end equipment like lidar, DC-DC converters, and traction inverters. We are now directly involved within the signal chain, playing a critical role in applications like gate driving, buffering, and translation. Now, this slide shows a spec table of our comparators, and most of these specs apply to our standard parts. Think of input offset, supply voltage, and quiescent current. But there are a lot of specs here, and it can be hard to know what is really critical for a system design. For this video, we're going to walk through the key specs of high-speed comparators. When it comes down to what makes the difference in a design with one of these devices, it's really limited to just a few specs. We'll also elaborate on each spec with a specific example. Now, obviously, when we talk about high-speed comparators, we know prop delay stands out as being very important. But beyond prop delay, there are a number of other specs that really make a difference. Think about overdrive dispersion, minimum pulse width, and toggle frequency. We'll discuss how each of these key specs directly benefits a system. So most people are already familiar with prop delay and why it matters. And this is really important for the electric vehicle applications, like the DC-DC converter, the traction inverter, EV charging, and onboard charging. This is a gate driving application where the comparator sits in between a processor on one side and a gate driver on the other. The newer, faster processors only output a 1.8 volt PWM pulse, while your gate drivers, even those designed for high-speed applications, will only work at 3.3 or 5 volts. This is where the comparator comes in, as it provides the level shifting capability up to the 3.3 or 5 volt driver input, and it is fast enough to work well with very high frequency signals. Another key spec in this application is skew. Some gate drivers will use dual inputs, and in applications where fast switching output is required, the inputs must precisely toggle to meet the correct output condition. Thus ensuring the low skew is important. We'll talk more about it in another example. It's also important to note that as you get into high frequencies, the propagation delay becomes a bigger factor of consideration as it allows for much more precise output waveforms. For power conversion and switching applications, the faster prop delay ultimately yields a better performance for the end equipment, making it more efficient through generating a smoother output waveform and reducing the size requirement of inductive coils. In weight-constrained EV applications, this can make a difference with lower weight for smaller coils. Now, what is overdrive dispersion? It's defined as the change in prop delay as a function of the change in overdrive voltage. Okay, but what exactly is overdrive voltage? Well, if we look at the inputs of a comparator, one pin is always tied to a reference, and the other will trigger when it exceeds that reference. Depending on the input signal, it may exceed the reference by just a few millivolts, or by a much greater factor of several volts. This amount of overdrive voltage has a direct effect on the prop delay. With a much stronger, higher overdrive, the comparator reacts faster, effectively creating a faster response than if a lower overdrive tripped the input. We see this in real-life applications playing an important role with LiDAR. The basic premise of LiDAR is measuring the time it takes a laser pulse to travel to an object and return. This allows for calculation of the object's distance using the comparator to trip on detection of the return signal. As long as the prop delay of the comparator is consistent, designers can easily calibrate out this delay from their distance calculation. But this is complicated when detecting surfaces of different colors and reflectivity. You can send the same pulse out, but point it at two different surfaces, each at the same distance, and the returning pulse will have two different amplitudes, and thus, two different overdrive voltages. This also means that you now see two different prop delays, even when measuring the same distance. So we try to minimize overdrive dispersion to make sure our prop delay is consistent. On the right side of this slide is a curve showing prop delay versus overdrive voltage. The difference calculated between a low overdrive and a high overdrive is nearly 300 picoseconds, which could result in a potential error of nearly 5 centimeters. At 100 meters, this might not matter that much, but at 1 meter, this could be huge. So the best way to lower overdrive dispersion and get the most precise reading is to go with a faster device that by definition has lower dispersion. On the left, our slowest TLV3601 has 2 nanoseconds prop delay and 600 picoseconds dispersion, while all the way on the right, our TLV3801 has 200 picoseconds prop delay and 5 picoseconds dispersion. Something also of interest, you may notice that the slower response devices are push-pull output, while the faster devices are LVDS. We'll talk about that further towards the end. Now, this next one here is one of my favorite specs, minimum pulse width. Essentially, it's just the most narrow pulse size that can be detected by a comparator without giving a distorted output. So if you look at the example below, you'll see how a comparator capable of detecting a 600 picosecond pulse width will change its output based on how narrow the input pulse is. A 1 nanosecond pulse will pass through no problem, while a 500 picosecond pulse will not get fully transmitted. But how does this affect a specific application? Well, going back to the LiDAR receiver, this can actually be really important. On the right here, we see how the pulse width can reduce the average power from case A to B. If we raise the amplitude but narrow the pulses, we maintain the same average power. This can be helpful in LiDAR receivers where detecting objects at greater distances requires a higher amplitude to detect that return pulse. Greater distance weakens the amplitude of the returning pulse. So for the same average power, a narrower pulse allows us to increase the amplitude and therefore the LiDAR range without increasing the power and violating eye safety standards. Now another key spec that is rarely mentioned with standard comparators is skew, which is also known as matching. Now this spec refers to the variation in response time between two different channels with reference to the input signal. And if you look in the datasheet, the value you see reflected indicates the amount of potential overlap across two channels. It's worth noting that when we compare skew between single channel parts and multi-channel parts, we notice that the skew is about 10 times greater when the channels are not on the same die. But why does this matter? Well, let's take the example of a LiDAR transmitter. In this circuit, the specific user is level shifting from 1.8 to 5 volts and driving a GANFET driver with a comparator. The challenge that occurs is getting the output pulse to be as narrow as possible so as not to exceed eye safety standards for laser light. The outputs of the comparator will need to align very precisely in order to generate the output laser pulse. So any mismatch in skew can have a large effect on that output pulse. You'll notice there is only a short time window where the comparator output intersects to generate that output on the driver. Therefore, any variation in skew can greatly affect the output pulse. A similar example using the same principle as above, only this time for a motor drive application, is here. Once again, the comparator level shifts to the gate driver, and one output directly controls the high side, while the other controls the low side. Any intersection in the on-off states of this motor driver could cause catastrophic damage to the system. So the low skew spec is needed to ensure that it does not happen as a result of comparator switching. Now, one final example of skew comes back to LiDAR in the application we call walk error. Using a dual comparator, two triggers can be set up so that when the return signal is detected, it will trigger both channels. Now the key here is that one comparator is set at a lower threshold and it will trigger slightly before the other, which is set at a higher threshold. By comparing the timing difference between the two channels, a processor can determine the walk error or the relative amplitude and thus understand the type of surface that has been detected. It is once again critical that the skew be negligible, as the measurement relies on two very small timing differences to calculate that walking error. Now, last but not least of our key specs is toggle frequency. This refers to the rate at which the comparator can switch from low to high without losing data on the output and maintaining a clean signal even at high frequencies. This plays an important role in many applications. But one example actually comes from test and measurement in an oscilloscope. The comparator in the scope application is monitoring the auxiliary trigger, waiting for an input signal to reach a threshold before quickly triggering. Because we may not know the exact frequency of the input signal, it becomes really important that our comparator has a very wide bandwidth so it can ensure the input will be detected even for high frequency signals. Moving to a faster comparator with a lower prop delay will also directly affect toggle frequency. We see a 9x improvement from TLV3601 to TLV3801. Now, previously, I showed output type as being an important consideration in high speed design. And while it can have a big impact on your application, it primarily affects the speed. With our recent release of TLV3601, TI now has the fastest push-pull comparator on the market, and the reason for that is it is nearly impossible to go any faster with push-pull technology. The basic equation featured here explains how faster response times require significantly more power consumption, making it impractical to continue using push-pull. So to go any faster than 2 nanoseconds or so, customer design has to incorporate LVDS outputs. And even LVDS eventually does have its limitations, necessitating moving to something faster like CML. Now, our final discussion for today is regarding some of the key features that are unique to high-speed comparators. But in this case, I'll specifically focus on hysteresis. Hysteresis is a useful feature for circuit designers as it allows them some level of control over how often to allow the output to change state, making it especially useful when the input is constantly held very close to the switching threshold. Without hysteresis, this type of system will cause the comparator output to chatter, or essentially change output high and low at a high frequency, often resulting in false triggers. Implementing a small amount of hysteresis can avoid this problem and help eliminate noise. Now, we can implement hysteresis externally, but in the case of a high-speed comparator, there may be a few reasons it's better to pick a device with internal hysteresis built in. First, there is the question of size. External hysteresis requires at least a few added resistors, and these may take up valuable board space that could be used for other functions. Second, it can also significantly improve design effort and performance. Due to the nature of high-speed process, very large bias currents are seen on the comparator inputs, which, with a resistor network from hysteresis, can create a very high input offset voltage. You will generally have to sacrifice the trip point accuracy with external hysteresis. This type of layout can also cause some additional parasitics to be seen throughout the circuit and may also yield slower response time. So selecting a device with internal hysteresis may be a better option depending on your design requirements. That wraps up our video for today. Thank you so much for watching.